Good afternoon!
Ciao Belly!
Hey! Jeff Rust is in the building. No Danny Morang, he's hoop summoning right now. He's summoning the hoops right now, which I actually...
He's got to watch it with that hip.
I said that I worry an injury is forthcoming.
Yeah.
I mean, if he summits anything,
yeah.
Summiting the stairs of Autzen Stadium when USC came to town was a problem.
Let's face it, summiting the stairs here at the building is probably a problem.
Yeah, wow. Fair.
Coming
but,
in hot.
Okay, you are coming in real hot. No, Danny, though, he is hoop summiting. So on the YouTubes right now, youtube.com/1080AM The Fan, it's like, I don't know, it's like an in memoriam here. Remember like when Michigan came out in honor of Jim Harbaugh in the line? Like we have just like this, Danny's not dead. He's very, yeah. very much alive.
Yeah.
Well, as far as we know,
yes.
very much alive.
We do not know otherwise. Yeah.
Yes.
And well, with the new graphics package, we do not yet have a solo host and producer cam set up. So.
You know, the graphics package is something that people always care about.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, yeah.
These are the burning questions.
Yeah. So for the YouTube folk, you gotta keep staring at one empty chair for the rest of the show.
Well, you know what I'm going to try and do? I'm going to try and fill that chair with something.
Okay.
Well, no promises on what that's going to be. right now, it's Danny and or the ghost of OJ.
And like, gee, wow.
Over there.
God, tickle me interested.
Well, I don't know. I don't know what to tell you, you know? Speaking of the ghosts of folks, did you see the big hubbub about Colorado last week where Dion, like, dressed his whole team down and was like, wow, you guys need to be going to class. I'm getting all of these reports from a professor about you guys need to take school seriously, and I love that.
Yeah,
I love that.
Are we really surprised that all the people that Dion has tried to bring in have zero interest in class?
No, but at the same time...
I wonder I can probably count on both hands how many classes Dion went to in college.
Well, I don't know. I have no idea.
I'm just guessing.
No idea. I don't think he Chad Johnsoned it at Oregon State where... He literally showed up to, like, the first day to pick up chicks and was like, deuces.
Or was it Cardale Jones? I didn't come here to play school.
That's right. Yeah. And then went back and got his degree.
Well, hey.
Yeah, he didn't.
Hey, look.
He went back and played school, though.
Yeah, that's great. And I'm not going to shame him for that.
No, he did. Absolutely.
Good.
He figured it out.
Exactly.
But Dion, and I appreciate that because, like, The cold reality is that all of these guys go to Division I football with the dreams of, like, I'm going here because I want to get to the NFL. That's a vast majority of players that are on scholarship at high-level Division I programs. And especially when you're going to play at Colorado and for Dion, obviously that is the allure. And that's what his big recruiting thing is. I'm going to get you to the league. But it's also, I appreciate Dion is taking it seriously. And he yelled at his team and said, get your butts to class.
Mm-hmm.
We fast forward a week. Did you see the video that surfaced today?
No.
It was Shedeur Sanders attending his first in-person classes at the University of Colorado. What? He has been there for over a year, and this is his first in-person class that he has taken at the University of Colorado.
I'm going to go ahead and assume it's not because he was previously learning remotely.
Well, that is it. Like, he was taking all online classes, which you can do, but it is just funny to me that it was like a week after Dion gives the get your butts to class, there is a YouTube video of Shedeur Sanders going, yep, going to class, first time ever. And it's like, he's been there for a year. I don't know how you, that is a hack of all hacks if he made it over a year without having to go actually into a lecture room.
Yeah. Well, that got me kicked out of Willamette.
What? Not going to class?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah, that'll happen, Jeff. Yeah,
right?
That'll happen.
I can't throw a football very well, though. So.
The allure of Jeff Rust being drunk in the student section. Was it MacArthur Stadium? Is that what it is down at Willamette?
Oh, I forget what the
Boy,
name of the stadium was.
Boy, if I know the name of Willamette Stadium, I got issues. I'm pretty sure it's MacArthur Stadium.
And most of the drunkenness was in the hoops gym.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
There you go. Well, we ride on YouTube, and that's where you can find Shedeur Sanders actually going to an in-person class for the first time at Colorado. He's just blown away by it. Like, wow, look at this. This is amazing what I'm doing right now. That's right. That's right. But I do appreciate Dion in that regard. Because a lot of guys, they're not going to the league. Guys, you're not going to the league. You're not.
Yeah. Well,
After watching them last year, there's a lot of guys that will not be playing in the NFL.
Well, and so do you suppose he did this on his own, or was he kind of spurred on by the the athletic department?
I don't know. I have no idea how that works.
Because I'm guessing he wasn't sitting down poring over the, you know, attendance sheets and whatnot and academic records of his players.
Oh, no. No.
I feel like it was brought to his attention.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, we've gotten this far into the show. We are 8 minutes in. Happy Masters Friday.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Absolutely.
We are in the midst of round two of the Masters right now. Round one wrapped up. Uh-oh. Now we need to take our voices down a little bit.
Yes.
Tell you about the Masters, where, hot damn, it's a great leaderboard.
It is.
I mean,
it really is.
Look, yeah. Sports pants getting a little tight for the weekend of the Masters.
You got the doucher up there who everybody loves to root against.
Yep. 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 May have made a mistake yesterday. Yeah. May have said DeChambeau in front of my 7-year-old, and gave me the look like. He has no idea what that word means, and I was like, I just said that wrong.
You know what?
DeChambeau.
I would pay money to get a forward look in about 20 years of Bennett. See what he's like in about 20 years. He's going to be a great kid, but there's going to be some peccadillos there.
There's some wild card moments I have with my kid. And it's my own doing, and you say some things and you're like, uh-oh,
shouldn't have said that.
That was not a good, yeah. That was not a good one to just spout off there in front of the 7-year-old. But, you know, like all great athletes, you got muscle memory, and apparently my brain is just trained, and I corrected. He doesn't, I think he knows it's DeChambeau. It's like, yeah. It's hard. I couldn't read it right.
Yeah, it all sounds the same, right?
Not good. Not good. But he's atop the leaderboard.
Yeah, and right alongside him, as Isaac would say, Scotty Scheffler. Which, he's American, so I don't know why he does that. But
it's a cool name to say.
Yeah.
It's a cool name to say. And Max Homa playing really well, too. Max Homa, Pac-12 love, West Coast guy.
Yeah, the homosexual, I heard Dirt say this morning on my way in. It's like, that's a new one.
Yeah, yeah, that's what his fans call themselves.
I'd never heard that until this morning on my drive in.
Mm.
Yeah. It's like, oh, okay, that's, yeah, sure.
No, that's it.
Yeah.
That's it. And he's a cool story, too, because I think golf needs to prop Max Homa up a little bit more, the golf world. Because remember, before he was actually, I don't know, good on the PGA Tour, he was known for roasting people's swings on Twitter. And he was just a savage. People just send the video like, what do you think of my swing, Max? And he will just dive in and just murder people on their golf swing, which is great. He's got a really good personality. He's now really good at golf and winning tournaments. The PGA Tour needs to hitch their wagon to Max Homa here.
Yeah.
And it's a good move when everybody that gets a name is jumping over the lip. It's a good move to prop up a guy like Max Homa, who's a real person, too. It's not like this prepackaged country club, you know, even though he is. but it's not the prepackaged country club stuffy dude. He's actually like a normal dude that plays golf.
Yeah.
And they need to prop him up a little bit more because he does have a fantastic sense of humor. And is a normal guy. And how often does like golf, like Bryson DeChambeau is a great example of this. Like when I think of golfers, like he is country club dude who thinks he's smarter than everybody because he actually is. He's like, I think at SMU he studied like astrophysics or something, or aeronautics engineering, something way smarter than I can do. But then makes you feel like he's way smarter than you are. You know,
mm-hmm.
You need to have the everyman. And that's what made Phil so popular was, now, Phil won a lot of tournaments, and he was way better than Max Homa is.
Yeah.
But the everyman is what people gravitated towards, right. Even though Phil Mickelson is not every man.
No, but he still just looks like a dude.
Yeah, yeah. And he looks like now, a dude. He's a normal guy.
Now he looks like midlife crisis dude.
Yeah. Yes.
He's looking a little gaunt.
He's got the same issues that Major League Baseball interpreters have. He's got, you know.
Well, I think he's a little more in the hole.
And oh, that is a great question. Who is the best worst gambler?
Right?
Because
wasn't there stories a while back where he's down like $100 million?
Yeah, that was like when he jumped to live. It was like, Phil needs the money. It's like, dude, Phil Mickelson? Oh, yeah.
Oh,
Phil
okay.
does need the money.
Yeah.
You know, those things happen to you. Mizuhara couldn't make any of that money back on a golf course, so he had to steal it from Shohei Ohtani. All right? And I love that Phil Mickelson has now just leaned into like Wario Phil, where he just wears black all the time. He's like, it may be because it's like black is slimming again because he Fit Phil was a thing. Now it's not as much Fit Phil.
Yeah, no, it's not. Yeah,
I mean, it's hard to be like in your late 50s and be mid 50s and be fit.
Right.
Yeah. You know, that's a hard thing to do.
Yeah.
But now he's just like, no, black is slimming. Never going to wear horizontal stripes again.
I'm a Phil. I'm a going to win.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep, that was my Wario.
That was it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll allow it. It was good. That was a good Wario.
All right.
That was a good Wario. Wow. Should I?
Wow.
Vancouver Ford text line just threw me off here. Because nobody calls me Dustin. Like, nobody in my life. Except for my mom when I was in trouble when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Nobody.
Yeah, right.
Like, quite literally, football coach in high school, went to the registrar, changed my name to Dusty on my transcripts. He's like, I'm not doing this. Uh-uh. I was like, oh, all right.
Yeah.
Well, here I am.
Yeah. Every time I heard the Jeffrey Ryan, I knew I had stepped in something.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jeffrey, you are a Ryan. I could see you being a Ryan. You'd make a good Ryan. They did. They churched you up a bit with Jeffrey.
Yeah.
But no, a Ryan is a good one.
Yeah.
Party animals, like guys who like to party, name Ryan.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
So you got that. Party's my middle name. Ryan.
Ryan.
Ryan and Kyle's.
Well, when I was a kid, my dad.
You're in for a good time if you're with a Ryan or a Kyle.
Well, my dad would call me JR, too, when I was a kid.
Oh.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Yeah. JR.
Well, JR Rust.
Yep.
Wow.
And when that came out, I knew I was okay, that I wasn't in trouble.
Was it Dallas who killed JR?
Yeah, right? Exactly.
Yeah, there we are. Yeah. This one threw me off. Dusty needs to have a soft voice. Counter personality, Dustin J. Hera, who covers sports in quiet Jim Nance fashion. I will do that for the people.
Hello, friends.
I don't know if we can hello friends it.
Yeah.
Because that's too Jim Nance.
Right.
Dustin J., which... I don't know where Jay came from, but I'll roll with it.
I feel like it fits.
It does fit. Not my middle name.
Yeah, you just roll it. I can just picture you at the top of the show. Just good afternoon.
Little NPR. Little sweaty balls.
Your balls look a little misshapen. Yeah,
we're going to talk a little football today and the business of football.
The NFL draft is coming up in a scant 13 days. Today we'll do a deep dive.
Is that really 13? 13 days?
13 days. We'll do a deep dive into Mel Kiper's mock draft 2.0.
All right. I think that is too sportsy to go into the, you know when you watch the news?
Yeah.
And the news person will be like, and here's Skippy the Squirrel, you know, like Ron Burgundy. He's like, Skippy the Squirrel is water skiing. Look at that.
Look at that.
Little guy, huh? How great is he? In other news, we had a murder. And it's like, whoa!
Yeah, the toss to break.
Like, they just do like a swipe on the screen. It's like, there's Skippy. He's water skiing around. Then you have the breaking news swipe. A murder happened. And they drop their voice. You're like, that? I wasn't expecting that one.
Yeah.
Woof.
That coming
That's a change.
Next at News 9 at 11.
That's a change.
Yeah.
So I think we need to go, our semi-serious news needs to go, like, I don't know. Anything that is downtrodden and just beat the Blazers. We could go The Blazers lost again last night to the Golden State Warriors. A valiant effort in Moda Center as 100-92, an 8-point loss, which is 58 better or 50, than 52 better than their 60-point loss a week ago. Coming up next,
only their second 60-point loss of the season.
We've got a new fart sounder.
Fart hammer.
Yeah. All right, 503-864-6326. That be the Vancouver Ford text line. All right, we got a lot that we got to get to today. Look, we're going to, it's a Friday. The sun is shining. This show may run the gambit, okay? We've got tiny statues.
Yes.
Chicken wings.
Yes.
Being to Portland. When being Portland, it goes, are you to Portland? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Those three pressing questions. We are midway through spring football for the Oregon Ducks. I think we can dive in, take a little inventory of the Oregon
Ducks
right now.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because they got their spring game coming up April 27th. What it'd be 15 days away.
Yes.
Huh?
2 weeks from tomorrow.
We got this spring game coming up, and there's a lot of interest around this Oregon football program because the turnover and the reload, not rebuild for Dan Lanning is in place here at the University of Oregon. And look, there's major names that are leaving this football program. But what the buzz is about the guys who are in camp right now, the transfer portal giveth in spades for the Oregon Ducks. We'll take a little inventory of that. No white smoke, but the Pope has returned to Kentucky. That will be on today's program. And
I see what you did there.
You see what I did there?
Yeah.
Was that good?
That was pretty good.
That was good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean.
That was a good one.
I hurt myself. Pat myself on the back.
Little Barry Horowitz.
But where we got to start this bad boy off, does he have it in him next on The Fan?
traffic upside down in under 30 minutes.
During Spring Fest at Lowe's.
Yacht Rock Friday. Yacht Rock Friday. Every Friday right here on Danny and Dusty from noon to three, you get the smooth beats from Jeff Rust.
Easing you into the weekend.
What's your favorite Yacht Rock song?
If just right off the top of my head, I'd have to say Feels So Good, Chuck Mangione.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Okay. Going deep with it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, the infamous swag pillow that was brought in here is my on the YouTube stream right now. He will be gone very shortly. I'm not a fan. Not a fan of this person. I don't know how Swag got this. Was it a white elephant gift?
I believe it was like a white elephant gift.
Yeah. All right. Well, he'll be gone soon.
Or he's just a large fan of North Korean dictators.
I don't think so.
No?
I don't think so. No. The infamous pillow is here, though.
Yeah.
We got the Masters leaderboard, and right now we have Bryson DeChambeau and Scottie Scheffler. They are leaders right now, 7 under par for the tournament. And as we always see at Augusta National, course tends to fight back. Score's not going low today, folks. I think right now you have best score on the course currently is 3 under. And that is a person I have never heard of in my entire life. Ludvig Åberg.
Yes, Ludvig, and I believe it's Isaac was going over this yesterday because of the single dot over the A. One might think it was Åberg, but apparently it's Ludvig Åberg.
Ludvig Åberg.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
I don't.
Which I was unaware of until yesterday.
I didn't even know that was a thing.
Nor
I didn't
did
know
I.
You put the circle over the O.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Yeah. So right. I had previously heard of him, but had not heard that pronunciation.
Ludvig Åberg is 3 under today, 2 under for the tournament. He's on 14. Most everybody, they're playing around even par, and we got a lot of big numbers that are coming in. No larger than, I love these ones. Every time I see them, it makes me feel normal. Emiliano Grillo. Of Argentina. He is our leader in the clubhouse for highest score of the tournament so far. He shot an 11 over 83 in his second round today. He will not make the cut. 15 over par for the tournament. That makes you feel a little bit more comfortable with your golf scores out there, which, if you're asking me, I would love to shoot an 83. I'd love to shoot an 83 at any golf course.
I would call that a win.
Let alone Augusta National. Yes. But for these guys, they're not too thrilled with that one.
No.
Right now, though, all eyes are on the top of the leaderboard, which if this holds and we head into the weekend with, you know, in a puncher's chance, you could have guys like Patrick Cantlay. You have Danny Willett, who former Masters champion, who is at 4 under par. Scottie Scheffler, Bryson DeChambeau, and Max Homa, as DeChambeau just bogeyed and he falls back. Now we have a 3-way lead at the top with Homa, DeChambeau, Scheffler. If you get names at the top of the leaderboard, we're in. I am all for this weekend.
Yes.
In the names that we have at top. The one story that I think a lot of us are following because he is Tiger Tiger Woods, he is 1 over par. Even on today's round, as he's working the 17th hole right now, And
he had to finish his first round this morning, too.
Yeah. So Tiger peg-legging it around. And look, even par, not Tiger scores that we're used to, but with the projected cut line being at five over, Tiger barring an implosion on the final two holes, he will be in line to make the weekend at Augusta National, which would be the 24th consecutive cut made for Tiger Woods at the Masters, which is a record, and he would stand alone with the most all-time cuts made at the Masters. And to think of where we talk about this all the time, like he's not probably not going to win another major. He won't win another major. The other golfers are too good. His body is too broken.
Yeah.
I mean, it is what we are looking for is just getting those flashes of Tiger again.
Yeah, some competitiveness.
And if he plays once a month, like he said, I think him making the cut with just where his game has been, having to withdraw at the Genesis, not playing a full round in Lord knows how long. Well, look, any Tiger that we get, if we can get him through the weekend, I'm here for it because it's nostalgia. It's the same reason why, you know, we watched, you know, Jack and Arnie, why it was such a great story when Fred Couples a couple of years ago or just last year, what you're sitting there and he's in the red heading into the week and you're like, hell yeah, Freddie Couples. Didn't happen this weekend. I think he is 12, finished his second round. He's 12 over. Not going to make the cut.
No.
But this is what the Masters does. And if we get Tiger into the weekend and he makes the cut again, I'm all for it. But it is weird what this tournament does to golfers and what it does to just average sports fans. You know, I had, you know, Zachary Jeans who on Twitter, he just fired me off a picture of right before the show started where he was like, current status. He's just got the azaleas on his TV watching the Masters. I don't know why. I mean, is it just that it is the allure and the aura of the Masters? Like, and we know this when in any sport, right? You know greatness when you see it.
Yes.
And you are gravitated, you gravitate towards greatness no matter what it is.
Yeah.
And just seeing this course and the fact that the best players in the world play the same place every year.
Yeah.
With the same pins every year.
Yep.
And we always see days like today where three under, it potentially could be the best round that we see all day today.
Yeah, after seeing 7-under yesterday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the course fights back, and we see meltdowns of epic proportion. And it's there's no secrets.
Yeah.
There's no secrets to what this course is going to give you, but it bites the best of them. And I think that is, like, to me, I love it when we have a leaderboard like we have right now where there's name recognition and name brands at the top. And sure, that's what gets people and gets the masses in, is that recognizable names at the top battling it out as they head into the weekend. That's fun. We love that. But for me, watching, like, so stupid to say, and Dustin J. Hare is going to say this, the course is the biggest competitor of this tournament.
No, it is. And from the fan perspective, what makes this tournament and this course so special, I think, is a lot of it is one, just the visual appearance of it on TV, it just looks different than any other course. And it's, I don't know if it's the way it fills the frame or whatnot. It seems like the greens are just greener. The flowers, they pop more. It just looks different than any other golf course on your TV. And then I think the other part of it is just kind of the exclusivity of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And even when it comes down to the television viewing windows and whatnot, it's like, I remember every year I curse. I'm like, why won't they show us, just put it on TV earlier? You too good for your home?
Yeah. And this text, Vancouver Ford text line, your dollar goes further at Vancouver Ford. They treat you right before, during, and after the sale. Visit them online at vancouverford.com. I think I have to do with the beauty of the course in most of us coming out of the crappy weather and into a nice spring. I think that has a lot of it too. It's like, it's like the official, like, hey, the good weather is back. It gives you those, that little comfort, that little woogie that you, that little blankie that you wrap yourself in.
Yep.
And there is some comfort to it because you're right. The greens pop. so much. And I cringe to think of like the amount of chemicals and what they are that yeah. make it this green.
Right.
And I don't care how much paint they use to make it look this way.
Yeah.
It's a thing of beauty, man. And when you hear guys like, do you hear the Brooks Koepka back and forth he had with a reporter?
No.
Reporter asked him, do you believe that 59 is possible at Augusta? And Brooks Koepka looks at him like, and he goes, have you ever played the course? And
you serious, Clark?
The reporter goes, not yet. And he goes, yeah, I could tell by your question.
Like, that's great.
You can go low. You ain't ever going that low, yeah. My friend.
Man. Well, just imagine. Well, here's what I wonder, though, too, is so take away the PGA Tour event aspect of it. So say Brooks Koepka went out there on just a random Sunday when it's just the course available to its members. Yeah. Do you think he could shoot a 59 then?
Like with in normal tee boxes and a normal setup?
Normal tee boxes, normal pins.
Yeah, without them being grass or the glassy greens that they're putting
if
on right now.
If it's just set up for the members.
Yeah. Like these guys are freaks.
Yeah.
I mean, it is. Like, I think it is Max Homa. Is it Riviera or... I don't know. It might be the LA Country Club, but Homa has the course record there.
Okay.
But not on PGA tees. Not. And right. That's a crazy part when you go to a golf course that hosts a PGA event. The tee boxes and where they put them, you're like, wait, what?
Yeah. Right.
They hit from there?
Yeah, exactly. Like,
that tee box is like past a ditch over a gully. And on a mountain.
It's not even connected to the hole.
So I think, like, yeah, you could do it. Like, they have this shot right here of, like, where they're teeing off from.
Yeah.
Is the most absurd place ever. Like, there's just this row of pine trees. And it's like, there's no way Condoleezza Rice and, you know, the CEO of IBM are teeing off from there.
Right? Yeah. Exactly.
Like, why would you pay, what is it? I don't even know what the dues are every year. It's an ungodly amount. But why would throw it out there, $150,000 a year to just go and get embarrassed?
You'll get your ass kicked every week.
Every time you play.
There's a reason why golf is a four-letter word.
Yes, ooh, buddy. You're not wrong. I've said a lot of four-letter words when I golf.
Yes. I think the best I heard it, was it you that said it? I heard somebody or somebody else.
Love.
That said, I'm not good enough to get mad.
That's
while
what
I
do.
Golf.
Yeah, that's me.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I said that yesterday.
Was that okay?
Yeah. It was just
I couldn't
yesterday.
Remember where it was. Yeah.
Good recall.
Yeah.
right. Masters going. It does look like Tiger is in line to make the cut. He is through 17 even today, one over the projected cut line at 5 over par. But you look at it and you say, all right. Some of the names: Dustin Johnson, +11.
By the way, the cut is 4 over.
No, five was doesn't make it to the weekend.
Gotcha.
But you got guys like Jordan Spieth, who no chance to make this thing.
Boy,
and
yeah,
his struggles continue. The great story of Gary Woodland, which we talked about earlier this week, and hitting that hole in one in the par three contest, he's not going to make the cut. Victor Hovland not going to make it. Keegan Bradley, Camilo Villegas, not going to make the cut.
I think Dustin Johnson, perhaps distracted by his wife's clothing, he's also way far away.
Yeah, and then guys like Hideki Matsuyama, he's right at 4 over par, where he's, you know, he has very little wiggle room as he's getting ready to make the turn into the back nine. He is 4 over par. Through 7 holes today. But I think we look at where the top of the leaderboard is. I like it, man. You be within striking distance. Lefty, Phil Mickelson, he's 1 under today. He's even par. Rory McIlroy is at even par. A lot of Xander Schauffele, which was like a betting favorite by a bunch of people, he's sitting at even. And when the top of the leaderboard is only 6 strokes, boy, it can evaporate in an instant at Augusta National. So there's a little Masters talk for you. 503-864-6326. That be the Vancouver Ford text line. All right, no smoke, but the Pope has arrived next on The Fan.
Now, Now, from the Fan Sports Desk, a SportsCenter update on 1080 The Fan.
This update brought to you by Crunch Fitness. Memberships as low as $9.99 per month. Find your crunch time at Portland, Vancouver, and online at crunch.com. First on The Fan, round two of the Masters at Augusta is underway and tied at the top. Max Homa, Bryson DeChambeau, and Scotty Scheffler all at 6 under par. They are 2 strokes clear of Nikolai Højgaard, Danny Willett, and Ryan Fox, coming in tied for 7th at 3 under par. Cameron Davis and Patrick Cantlay. Some other big names. You got Colin Morikawa at 2 under par. Will Zalatoris, 1 under. Phil Mickelson, Rory McIlroy, even par. Tiger is even par on the day, leaving him at 1 over overall. And Jason Day is at 3 over. Looks like, alongside John Rahm, looks like they are probably safe for the weekend. All 30 teams in the NBA on the schedule tonight, and the Blazers are one of them, hosting the Rockets at Moda Center. 7 o'clock tip on Root Sports. Portland 6.5-point dogs. Kentucky has officially named Mark Pope as their new men's basketball coach. Pope was a captain on the Wildcats' 96 national championship team. He's been the head coach at BYU for the last 5 seasons with an overall record of 110 and 52 in Provo with 2 tournament appearances. And on the diamond, Mariners back at T-Mobile Park for a 6-game homestand. Cubs in town for a weekend set. Jordan Wicks, Bryce Miller is your pitching matchup. 6:40 first pitch on Apple TV+. More sports scores and stories in 30 minutes. I'm Jeff Rust at the Fan Sports Desk. Listen live or on demand on the Odyssey app, the Fan's desktop player, or tell your smart speaker to play 1080 The Fan.
Your favorite fan shows are on YouTube. Mash the subscribe button and like us for live streaming video and 1080 The Fan on demand.
Hey, it's Dusty. When my family and I are in a time crunch or just want a delicious meal, our go-to is always Victorico's Mexican food. My favorite is the Northwest Burrito. My kids love the rolled tacos. With several area locations, it's easy to pick up Victorico's. Order online now at victoricos.com or on the mobile app.
3 little words no parent wants to hear.
My tummy hurts.
And it always seems to happen at the worst times. Like in the middle of the morning rush, when you still have homework to check and lunches to pack, and of course, you're already late for work. Luckily, there's Pepto-Kids. Pepto-Kids gummies help relieve occasional stomach upsets, turning those 3 words into these 3 words.
I feel better.
Bad time for stomach upsets? Good time for Pepto-Kids gummies. Fast support for little tummies.
These statements have not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. This product is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Stone Creek Golf Club was just named the best public golf course in Oregon, with green fees under $100, and for good reason. The Peter Jacobson Design Course features stunning views of some of the best greens in the state. Stone Creek offers the best of the Pacific Northwest for your next round event or tournament. But that's not all. You can save big with excellent twilight rates after 4 p.m. or find exclusive online-only offers at stonecreekgolfclub.net or by booking through the Stone Creek app. Book your Stone Creek tee time today.
For more than 50 years, P.G. Long has been helping the Pacific Northwest with floor covering, cleaning, and restoration. We know for contractors and property managers that time is money. P.G. Long's team of experts is ready to help you get the right product installed, cleaned, or repaired on time and on budget. Whether you need carpet, hardwood, or laminate, luxury tile, waterproof flooring, or even waterproof FIBO wall panels. When you need it, P.G. Long has you covered. Find them online at pglongllc.com. P.G. Long, your Northwest flooring experts.
Dive into 3 days of savings throughout the store at Coastal.
Coastal Farm and Ranch, we're just what the country needs.
From now until April 14th, stop by for an unbeatable shopping experience during the 3 days of savings sale.
All right. Kentucky has hired a new basketball coach. Mark Pope is the new head coach at the University of Kentucky. A big suit, got to be big mad about this one. They took his guy. The BYU head basketball coach has taken over at the helm of Kentucky after John Calipari bolted for Arkansas, where he met with the team, and there is no team. And now you look, this has been...
Like, is that the Hoops equivalent of Deion coming in and saying, I need a whole new damn offensive line?
Yes. Yes. Except for no new team. Met with the team, there is no team. Yeah. This is one of those come to Jeebus moments for the Kentucky basketball program, because think of where they are here at this point. You had John Calipari, who recruited five-star after five-star and had an inability to get over the hump. Their last national title, 2011, where, you know, he was the head coach for that team. Mm-hmm. But we see, like, this year was the tipping point. A first-round loss and an early exit. You get bounced as a three seed, and you're going to have two, potentially three lottery picks coming off of that roster. And they were done with, hey, we are sick of being the team that sends guys to the NBA, but we don't win championships. We don't get to Final Fours. We're not getting to the Elite Eight as consistently as our expectations hold. And we've been, now we're getting lapped by the likes of Villanova and UConn. And look, there's a slippery slope from with the Blue Blood basketball programs from being dominant and then becoming what Indiana is, becoming what, you know, UCLA. Think about it. Since Ben Howland,
yeah,
UCLA has been a roller coaster,
yeah,
and it's not been consistently great at UCLA.
Although Mick Cronin has been pretty good.
Mick Cronin is a great coach. This year was a disaster for them. And that's kind of that roller coaster that they ride, where optimism was high. They had, you know, all the hope in the world that they would be back, and then it goes back down. What kind of the reporting out of Kentucky was is that there was a power play made by John Calipari, where when he and Mitch Barnhart, the athletic director at Kentucky, had their meeting together, and it was, hey, we're going to run it back one more year because, I don't know, 36 million reasons why and your buyout. But we got to get things going to where we're winning games, not just getting people to the NBA.
Right.
The unrest within the supporters and the boosters rubbed Calipari the wrong way. Like, hey, I've won national titles. I've been to Final Fours. I know how to coach basketball.
Which, by the way, your first point there, I didn't realize he has won a national title.
Yes.
For some reason, I had it in my brain that there was more. But, yeah, just 2012. That'd be it.
But, I mean, look, we do this all the time. Winning national titles is so damn hard.
Well, no, it is. But look, that's you're also Kentucky.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and he was there, what does it say, 2009 to now, and he has one to show for it. Like, that's not acceptable for Kentucky.
Well, but you also take that a lot of the things that have happened with Coach Cal are he goes and wins places, and then those wins get taken away, whether it's UMass or Memphis or in getting to, like, we look at it, getting to the Final Four is a really, like, winning a national title is obviously the pinnacle, but going to the Final Four is, I mean, that is the ultimate success you can have as a coach, right?
Yeah.
It's like you get to Final Fours, and how many Final Fours has John Calipari been to?
I see.
Six times he's been to the Final Four.
Yeah.
96, 2008, vacated. 2011, 12, 14, and 15, right? But at Kentucky, when you're looking at it and going, our last Final Four was in 2015, and here we are, like, that's 9 years ago.
It's 2024.
They expect more. That comes with the expectations. Cal tried to go with the power play of, all right, I'm going to go and I'm going to talk to Arkansas and I'm going to sweeten the pot and make this move of, all right, it's either me or him with the AD, right? And Barnhart. Nope. They said bye. And at that point, we get to the point where Kentucky basketball is right now. And like, this could be in the grand scheme of things, Calipari's power play may actually work in his favor. He's at Arkansas, but at the end of the day, You look at all of the names that turned down this job or had no communication, whether it was Nate Oates or in Billy Donovan getting out ahead of it.
Yeah.
Saying, nope, yeah, not going. Whether it is Dan Hurley, who publicly was saying, I'm not going anywhere. Scott Drew turning down the job. Jay Wright saying no interest in the job.
Yeah.
And if like,
so you got
and
Alabama,
Kentucky fans,
Baylor, and Villanova saying no thanks.
Well, and a former Villanova.
Former Villanova, excuse
yeah.
me.
Yeah. But Jay Wright, like, you're crazy, and Kentucky fans are crazy if they don't think that all of those guys were on their list. This is not a situation that, like Alabama football, where they can say, you know, no, Kalen DeBoer, we had him targeted as one of our top guys. He was our top guy. Mark Pope is not going to be at the top of anybody's list. And if Mark Pope is not successful at Kentucky, then you see all of a sudden that Mitch Barnhart is going to be on the way out, because there is one thing that they love, and it is their basketball at the University of Kentucky. And Pope is a former player. He was a captain of the 96 national title team. He's done a very good job at his two previous stops, whether it was Utah Valley, well, I guess it's not Utah Valley State anymore, Utah Valley University, or BYU, where he got BYU humming, and they were a six seed this year. But at the same time, the two tournament appearances that he has under his belt have been very Calipari-esque, haven't they? Yep. He's been a six seed twice, got upset by 11 seeds in both those years. Remember, a couple years ago, it was UCLA that did it to him. And this year, like, the upset that people were shocked at, because Duquesne was a six seed in their own tournament, conference tournament, the 11-seeded Dukes upset BYU this year in the first round. So you sit there and you go, all right, you got a coach who has his ties to Kentucky. He did the most BYU thing ever. Did you see the video that he released? I mean, there's going to be a lot of golly gees and fiddlesticks rolling around that video.
Gosh darn it.
Because BYU is the only place that you can pull this thing off without, like, you getting murdered on the way out of town. But in the BYU gym, he rips off a sweatsuit as he's saying he's happy to be the Kentucky coach, and he's got his Kentucky uniform on underneath his little suit that he was wearing, and said, I'm ready to go. I hope Mark Pope does succeed at BYU. But if he doesn't, it's going to look back and everybody's going to go, Barnhart, what a fool. You let John Calipari walk. You didn't give him more security. And here we are now, because that slope is so slippery in the world of college hoops. And look, blue bloods, they don't mean what they used to anymore. They really don't.
Yeah.
They really don't. Because without Calipari there, does Kentucky, with young kids, think of 18-year-olds getting recruited right now, okay? We just said it. 9 years ago was the last time they made a Final Four. 9 years ago. And without Coach Cal being the guy who gets guys to the NBA, is the cachet going to be as big of a pull for young recruits? That's a legitimate question. It is, because these kids, they don't look at the world like we used to, where tradition and history meant so much.
Right.
They really don't in recruiting. Andrew Nemec, who was on last night, he'll tell you this, man, time and time again, that the blue blood programs, if you're not good right now, they don't care.
You know what? Because, when was the last time Indiana was worth a damn?
Ooh. Tom Crean had a year.
Right?
Tom Crean had a year.
I mean.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. It's a big risk for the University of Kentucky, but Mark Pope, the Pope returns. Rex Chapman is on board.
Yeah.
Rex Chapman is
Rich's brother.
Rich's brother. Yeah. Rex Chapman is on board. So they got that going for him, which is nice. 503-864-6326. It's crazy. Nobody wanted that Kentucky job, though.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah.
That's crazy. All right. Let's take a look at being to Portland next on The Fan. Oh, yeah. Heck yeah. A lot of Anchorman references today.
Yeah.
Rotator popping up Afternoon Delight.
Right. Well, I had to go insert this one in there. Rufio brought it up. I was like, I don't know how I missed that. Never put it in there. So.
What a great song.
This is in honor of P1 Rufio.
Perfect. My new co-host is Sam Elliott. He has taken over for Kim Jong-un, who was in the chair earlier.
Catalonian beef ragu.
Yeah, that's right. Oregon's own, Sam Elliott.
That's right.
Just sitting in that chair, just hosting the show, just running right along.
Barbecued beef ribs.
That's right. That's right. If you, hey, you know what? If you are in the YouTube chat, youtube.com/1080amthefan, if there's a co-host you'd like to see, go ahead, pop off. Let's go. YouTube.com/1080amthefan or twitch.tv/1080amthefan where you can watch us.
Yeah, we got ideas, but we'll take suggestions.
All right. Well, we were talking so much Masters and Kentucky basketball. This is turn and burn here because we've got to get to the real story of the day. When being to Portland is a real thing,
mm-hmm.
we're going to have to put a poll up on this one.
Yeah.
We're going to have to put a poll up on this one because a Portland legend is spending his offseason standing for one of the great staples of the Portland area.
And this is a divisive topic, too.
Is it really?
Oh, yeah.
Is it really that divisive?
This is a terribly divisive topic.
All right.
There's not a whole lot of in-between.
Okay. Well, coming up next hour, we've got our worst day on the web. Tiny little statues. Little baby statues out there. We'll have to run through, we're going to go through Oregon spring ball, midway point of spring ball for the Oregon Ducks. We'll take a look at where they stand. We got some NFL draft stuff as well. Partying along with us, this is Danny and Dusty on The Fan.
Have a big event. about you something else.
Hour number two, Danny and Dusty with you on this Friday afternoon. Thank you for being a part of our day, letting us be a part of yours. New co-host is none other than the great John Daly. John Daly over in that seat. You can see it on YouTube.
Sucking down a heater.
Sucking down a chili dog.
Well, yeah, we haven't heard that one for a while.
No, we haven't. I don't even know where that's at.
Is it even on the page? I'm not sure it is.
Oh, it is. It's got to be on. It's got to be on here. We'll get that. We'll get that to you. But that was one of my all-time favorite drops. We got to play that. How do you not? Okay, that's a you drop. How are you? I don't like this. I don't like this that you are manipulating our drop. Here we go.
Sucking on a chili dog. Sucking on a chili dog, sucking on a chili dog.
All right. Hour number two, we got to start with the pressing news of the day here. I was on Twitter just perusing social media yesterday as the Blazers were playing the Golden State Warriors. Fun little game. That was a fun little game last night.
Yeah.
Blazers Warriors. It really bothers me when the amount of Warriors fans that you see in Moda Center, you know,
yeah,
that like they've taken over the Lakers now as like the team that when they come, they just take over
right
the arena. Yeah. And I don't blame them. I don't blame Blazer fans right now. I mean, this is, you're in the doldrums and that's the second to last home game of a really tough season, but doesn't make it right. I'm sitting at home watching on TV getting pissed and not in the arena. I'm like, bah, they need to be more Blazers. No, it's fine. But as I'm sitting there and I'm watching the game, I notice right across my Twitter feed comes none other than Damon Stoudemire out of left field. The head coach at Georgia Tech replies to Portland Business Journal's tweet that says Colt Burger chain In-N-Out is inching closer to Portland. And Damon Stoudemire, just with a quote tweet that says, Burgerville is better.
Hey, he's right.
And then he quote tweets his own quote tweet with, first stop every time I'm in town. You're not from Portland if you hate on Burgerville. Boy, that is true.
Mm-hmm.
That is very true. But I was surprised with how many people were coming back at Mighty Mouse with the, In-N-Out is better.
Yeah, well, it's because most of these people only know In-N-Out and probably, I'm guessing anyway, and do not know the greatness that is the Ville of Burgers.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. They're Californians that haven't even given Burgerville the try.
Right.
So we have it up at Danny and Dusty on Twitter. Better fast food burger joint, Burgerville or In-N-Out? Currently, Burgerville leading the way, 61% of the vote.
As it should.
38% or 38.9% is going towards In-N-Out right now. I don't know if this is just me. The burgers at both places are very different.
Okay? Yes.
But where Burgerville gets me is the fries.
Mm-hmm.
The seasonal shakes.
Yes.
Like the shakes at In-N-Out, a good shake.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with it.
It's a fine shake.
Not the Burgerville. Burgerville's got some of the best shakes.
Mm-hmm. Have you tried the rosemary, like garlic fries there too?
Oh,
with the garlic aioli.
Yeah, now we're talking. See, the fries are way better. In-N-Out's fries are terrible.
Yeah.
We can agree on that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's okay. They've got a great burger and they've got good shakes. I think Burgerville's superior in both categories, though.
Yep.
I really do.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the cult following of In-N-Out,
yeah,
the palm trees out front, the T-shirts that they have. They've got this branded perfectly.
Yeah.
In-N-Out, very good. I enjoy going to In-N-Out.
Sure.
I don't know.
It's great.
I've to the one in Salem twice.
Yeah.
I think I've been to the one in Medford twice.
I've been to the one in, Kaiser Station, is that right?
But I go down to California. In-N-Out is a tradition with my family when we go down to Southern California.
It's one of those things like
go to the In-N-Out.
Yeah. When in Rome, do as the Romans.
We cannot sit here and pretend as if the In-N-Out is so far superior to the Burgerville burger.
Because it's just not.
Or the In-N-Out milkshake is superior to the Burgerville milkshake.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know what you're thinking if you think that.
Now, is pricing the issue here.
Could be.
I mean, I think that is probably the big one.
Burgerville is pricey.
It is far more.
Even for their just basic little cheeseburger, which is, by the way, that's all I ever get there. It's just the little basic cheeseburger. Get a couple of those and some fries.
All right. We got some quick feedback here. DB Cooper's tweeted us, wow. Easiest way to spot a transplant is by this poll right here. It truly is.
Yeah.
It really is.
Absolutely.
And then Josh says, if you vote in and out on out here, I'm going to need you to leave the state.
Build that border wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But this is the thing with, I think the breadth of the menu too, the options that you have.
Yeah. Cause in and out, you don't, you know, they have their secret menu, but really outside of that, it's a very basic menu.
It is a basic menu.
In and out a bunch of basic bees, man.
But I think that where we do have some pushback is like this texture says, you know, Burgerville value and quality has gone way downhill. I don't think the quality has.
I don't think the quality has, but they are pricey.
Yeah. Yeah. The pricing may be what sways people one way or the other on this, you know? And I still think though, it's uniquely Portland. We got, you've got to go for it. And I just love the fact that that's how Georgia Tech's basketball coach is spending his offseason, is defending the honor of the great Burgerville franchise out of nowhere, just out of left field. And to think of when that tweet was sent, like think of Damon Stoudemire is presumably living in Atlanta, Georgia still. Is that a safe assumption to say?
I mean, yeah.
That tweet
coaching
came,
Georgia Tech.
That
yeah.
That tweet came at 11:20 p.m. in Atlanta. He was like, "No, this injustice will not stand."
Well, tell you what.
In the middle of the night, I spend my days recruiting for Georgia Tech and spending time on the Yellow Jackets basketball program. My nights are dedicated to defending the honor of Burgerville.
I'll tell you what. I hate to speculate here, but I have a feeling that it may lead to an old quote that I think was Damon Stoudemire's.
Yeah.
We smoked it all.
Nope, that's Cliff Harris.
Damn it.
That's Cliff Harris.
Okay.
That was a great quote by Cliff Harris. I'll tell you one. I mean, that one was nails from Cliff Harris. Where is the marijuana? We smoked it all. Yep, that was not Damon Stoudemire.
Damn. All right. Well, anyway, that would have been good if I was right.
Mm.
Yeah. Anyway,
mm.
Not that he didn't have his issue, you know. What was it? His was the tinfoil at the airport, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
I think so.
I think that was it.
Yellow Hummer coming down from Seattle?
Yeah.
Was he in that? I get my Jailblazers marijuana instances mixed up. The one that I will never forget
so many.
Is J.R. Ryder out of a pop can on the side of the road.
I believe it was Pepsi?
Mountain Dew, maybe? I don't know. I don't know. But that one will always stick with me because it was like, really?
Yeah, right?
Really?
Like, really? You could
a
you
can?
Yeah, you didn't have a piece?
Like,
come on, man.
What do we do? Really? You didn't go home?
Right. I mean,
really?
Yeah. You couldn't go swing by the Dragon Herbarium or something?
And this was like this was in Lake O. You couldn't have been too far from home.
Right? Yeah, wait 5 minutes.
Man, what are we doing? What are we doing?
Oh,
that's
man.
The one that will always stick with. Other than that, and Quintel Woods using a bat, his rookie card as a piece of identification when he got pulled over. Those two cemented in my brain in Jailblazers lore. Everything else is just a smash them all together. I can't remember who, what, when, or where.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Okay. This is Texas. Russ, you were only a decade off on that one between Cliff Harris and Damon Stoudemire. Two different sports.
Look, the timeline was not my concern.
It was all the same.
Yeah.
I mean, we ended up, we landed in the same spot.
Right, exactly.
Landed on the same spot.
We just took a circuitous route.
All right, so the poll is up. We will revisit this in hour number three because I think this is something that we really need to get to.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
Let's go.
People are passionate about it.
I heard you say all 30 teams in the NBA in action tonight.
Yes, and also on Sunday, apparently. I learned that from Colin Cowherd this morning.
Well, yeah, no, that's their big push where they're doing like similar start times too.
Yeah.
So you don't have the
scoreboard
tanking
watching
for position.
Yeah.
Going on.
Yeah.
But tonight is a big night across the NBA. Blazers be damned. Like, one of the most meaningless games in the NBA tonight is the Portland Trailblazers against the Houston Rockets,
mm-hmm.
where neither one of them have much to play for tonight. Yeah. But there's a ton to play for in a lot of really intriguing matchups across the NBA. Where the dust may settle as we head in to the final weekend of the NBA's regular season. Danny and Dusty on the Fan. Busy night across the association in the NBA. We've got all 30 teams in action tonight, which leads us to a pretty light schedule for the weekend, as no games are on Saturday. I like what the NBA is doing with this. You know, it's fun for the fans that everybody's going to play tonight on Friday. You have no back-to-backs heading into the final day of the season.
Mm-hmm.
You have, you know, back-to-backs heading into tonight, obviously Portland and Golden State.
Yep.
Two of those teams. But you get this final push where everybody's going to have a day off, and then the final day on Sunday, everybody plays, and all of the start times are right around in that same window, right? I think they all range from 10 a.m. For the Eastern Conference teams, or most of them, and then 12:30 for most of the Western Conference teams. That's really smart on the NBA.
Yeah, the whole docket is between 10 a.m. and 12:30 on Sunday.
But what I like about all of this is that, you know, think of it back in, I don't know, we don't have to go back too far, right? Because I saw a tweet last night that was, it is fascinating to me, that we have currently 10 teams in the West are 10 games over 500. That's an incredible number, because this person, Nick, I want to give him the right credit, Nick Engstat, said we have 10 teams that are 10 games over 500 in the West. If you go back to 1991, this would be the most ever. We've had nine sprinkled in quite a few times where you've had nine teams, 10 games over 500, but there's never been a season where there've been 10 teams over 500. And just think of like what this would have been like for, you know, like the Portland Trailblazers. Okay. Which if you go back to 2015, there were seven. Remember that year where there were seven 50 win teams in the Western Conference?
Yeah.
And the Blazers were one of them.
Yeah.
51 and 31. Life comes at you fast. But that was also 9 years ago, which also time goes really fast. COVID screws all that up.
Yeah.
But that was the year that Blazers were in that 4-5 matchup with the Memphis Grizzlies, and they got the floor mopped by Memphis in that series. But think of that. In 2015, you had the Warriors with 67 wins. The Rockets with 56, the Clippers with 56, Memphis, San Antonio each had 55, the Blazers had 51, the Mavericks had 50 wins. And so if you were to think about the way the playoffs are set now, Portland, because that was when divisions were a thing, even though they weren't,
right?
Portland ended up as the 4 seed with 51 wins. Imagine if it was now, though, where a win between, if you were to look at it with the current NBA landscape, the Blazers and the Mavericks, if you were entering that final day, a win or loss would be dependent on whether you played the Rockets or the Clippers in the playoffs that year. Injuries matter. Like, how much is at stake between that 2 and 3 seed and that path towards the conference finals? Nobody was getting past the Golden State Warriors that year. But I like the way that they stagger everything now, because it makes for an exciting push and a furious finish to the NBA season. And now we have all 30 teams tonight, a day off. And then Sunday, it's going to be must-watch TV.
Yeah.
The only thing the NBA screwed up on, which they do quite often, is they're going head-to-head with Sunday at the Masters.
Yeah, that's a rough spot, definitely. But, I mean, this is the time your season ends every year. And I mean, the Masters usually, for some reason, I feel like I always remember the Masters like almost always being on Easter. So it feels weird that this year it's not that. But yeah, it's going up Sunday afternoon against the Masters, you're not going to have a whole lot of eyeballs. But the good thing about having it just basically both in those two different TV windows is, as you mentioned in the break, it eliminates a lot of the scoreboard watching by the teams in terms of who's going to be the tankopotamus and who's, you know, they just got to go out and play.
100%. All right, what's online tonight? The Denver Nuggets can clinch the 1 seed in the West with a win tonight. And Denver plays San Antonio. Probably going to chalk that up as a win. But they also need losses by the Oklahoma City Thunder and the Minnesota Timberwolves. Thunder play the Bucks, and that game is very intriguing because of you think of where both those teams are. You're in the second to last game of the season, and Milwaukee, they need to win without Giannis Antetokounmpo. They need to win this game against OKC in order to clinch the 2 seed in the Eastern Conference. Damian Lillard, we've seen him drag teams before that have been far worse off to more improbable wins. This is where Dame needs to kind of turn it on for Milwaukee. And that game has a ton of intrigue based on both conferences. The Eastern Conference 2 seed could be clinched with a win by Milwaukee, but also a loss for Oklahoma City in a win by Denver. That gap is they're staring down the 3rd seed. Minnesota, on the other hand, they've got the Atlanta Hawks. And so I don't anticipate the 1 seed in the West being clinched tonight. But that is a clinching scenario for the Denver Nuggets. And think of where they were in post-All-Star break, what the Denver Nuggets have done. Closing that gap on both Minnesota and Oklahoma City, erasing it in an instant, and then just being kind of the embodiment of consistency that Michael Malone and the defending champions have kind of created in Denver.
You know, one of the things that I think has been a bit under discussed,
okay. And
ooh. which is mind-boggling, the number one Boston Celtics are 13 games clear of the number 2 seed Milwaukee Bucks.
Their dominance has been impressive in the regular season over the last handful of years.
They're the only 50-win team in the East, and they've got 62 wins.
Now, this is always going to be the question with the Boston Celtics is, we know they have a great regular season roster, and with Drew Holiday there is a big difference because the last couple of years, it's been they don't have a guy that can dribble and get them out of hairy situations at the end of games. Mm-hmm. Drew Holiday is, one, a phenomenal perimeter defender.
Mm-hmm. And they've since locked him up, too.
And yeah, they assigned him to an extension yesterday.
Yes.
$136 million. Nice.
Yeah, nice.
Former Blazer great.
It.
Former
yeah.
Blazer great. Drew
Blazer,
Holiday.
Blazer
paid.
Legend.
Getting paid, but they needed a ball handler and perimeter defense. That could be a big game changer when it comes to the playoffs. Boston needs to prove it in the playoffs, because last year when you get bounced as the 1 seed after another phenomenal regular season run by the 8 seed at Miami Heat. Now, Miami goes to the NBA Finals, so it didn't look that bad at the end of the day. You can't have that happen, though, in back-to-back seasons.
Mm-hmm.
Boston, this is a big year for Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown. And so I'm going to be them in the playoffs. That's going to be where my eyes are, because they are the most dominant team in the East, and it's not even close.
Yeah. Well, I'd say that Drew Holiday has proven to be a pretty nice little replacement for Marcus Smart.
You think?
I think that's worked out okay.
You think?
I think.
Also, you have CJ McCollum and the New Orleans Pelicans with a win over the Warriors tonight and a loss by the Phoenix Suns. They can clinch a playoff spot and avoid messing with that play-in at all. And look, they make this schedule so far in advance, it's hard to see what games are going to be primo heading into the second to last game of the season. But you've got Warriors and Pels, and Golden State is in a fight, because if you look at it, there's a 3-way tie, 8-9-10, between Sacramento, Golden State, and LA, right?
Mm-hmm.
So all of them, you have Golden State with a hell of a lot to play for. And then for Sacramento, they play the Phoenix Suns, which they need a win to try to avoid the play-in game heading into the final Sunday of the season.
Mm-hmm.
You have both of those have huge implications for what the play-in will look like, and then what the playoffs will look like with New Orleans and Phoenix both playing Golden State in Sacramento.
Well, now, and also let's not forget too, outside of even playoff seeding and whatnot, these are a couple pretty important games for your Portland Trailblazers too.
Yes, sir.
Because they have an outside shot and they need some help. But they have an outside shot where they're currently the fifth worst record in the league. They could go all the way down to 3rd.
They still could do that.
They have a 1-game, air quotes, lead over Charlotte and San Antonio. They have the Charlotte and San Antonio each have 1 more loss than the Blazers.
All right, San
with
Antonio
2 games remaining.
San Antonio plays the Nuggets tonight.
Okay,
that's a loss. That's a loss. Boston plays the Hornets. That's a loss. So you're not making up any ground there.
Right.
If you look at what is on tap for Sunday, the Hornets play the Cavaliers, and the Cavaliers are one of those teams where they've got a ton to play for right now too, because as it currently stands, they are the 4 seed. They could bump themselves all the way up to the 3 seed mm-hmm. if New York loses in their final two and they win their final two, but they could also fall all the way back down to the 6 or potentially the 7 if they lose both their games. So Cleveland has a ton to play for heading into the final two games of the season. That's who Charlotte plays. And then wrapping it up at the end of the season, the Spurs have the Detroit Pistons, which mm-hmm. that's a tasty, that could be a tasty little victory. The Blazers could finish dead last in the Western Conference.
Right. Now, also, let's not get ahead of our skis here in terms of the Hornets and the Celtics being an automatic loss, because the Celtics have absolutely zero to play for.
That is true.
And they've got guys on the injury report already and saying that they're you know, most of their big guys are really not going to play much over the next two games.
I present to you the Charlotte Hornets as my counter-argument.
That's a strong counter-argument.
To which, as Danny Meringue dubbed it, the great suck-off. They found a way to lose that game against the Portland Trailblazers. Was that just over a week ago?
Yeah.
So, like, do not underestimate the power of the Charlotte Hornets to be an absolute abomination of a basketball team, if need be. What we do need, though, is, look, CJ McCollum to go off for, like, 9 three-pointers again and to sink the Golden State Warriors, because the further down they get pushed into that Western Conference play-in, the better it is for the Blazers, if we're being quite honest. Mm-hmm. Like, if they can't get out of the play-in and they've got to win two, that's the spot that Blazer fans want the Warriors to be in.
Yep.
I just have zero faith in the Lakers. The Lakers are... That look that LeBron James gave the other night, that is just ingrained in my head of him just dejected on the bench, just being like, what am I doing? Why am I here?
Why am I here?
What's happening? All right, so there's your play-in scenarios and your playoff scenarios as we enter second to last night of the NBA. Go Blazers! How about that? You know?
Yeah.
I'm all for this. Get into those bottom three.
Yeah, exactly.
At all costs.
Yes.
Let's go.
No, I'm not sure of any of the tiebreaker scenarios and how those are all working out in their favor or against them.
That win over Charlotte was not good.
It hurt.
Yep.
It hurt.
That hurt. That's a big win loss.
Yeah, it was brutal,
It's
dude.
A big win resulting in a loss.
Yeah.
All right, let's get to our worst day on the web. This is how you're going to honor one of the best players in NBA history. Next.
Now, from the Fan Sports Desk, a SportsCenter update on 1080 The Fan.
This update brought to you by Crunch Fitness. Memberships as low as $9.99 per month. Find your crunch time in Portland, Vancouver, and online at crunch.com. First on The Fan, round two of the Masters at Augusta National is underway, and all alone at the top, Bryson DeChambeau, 7 under par overall. He is even par today through 14. One stroke back are Max Homa and Scottie Scheffler at 6 under par. Tied for fourth, three strokes off the pace are Nikolai Højgaard and Danny Willett. Some other names of note, Colin Morikawa finishes his day. He is 3 under overall. Will Zalatoris, even par. Tiger Woods, Phil Mickelson, Rory McIlroy, all at 1 over par. John Rahm at 3 over, and Jason Day is 4 over, which looks at this point he will be making the weekend. All 30 teams, as we discussed, in the NBA are on the schedule tonight. The Blazers, of course, are one of them, hosting the Rockets at Moda Center. 7 o'clock tip on Root Sports. Portland 6.5-point dogs. They do own the 5th-worst record in the league, but still have an outside shot at finishing with the 3rd-worst record for those interested in ping-pong balls. Kentucky has officially named Mark Pope their new men's basketball coach. He was the captain on the Wildcats' 1996 national championship team and has been the head coach at BYU for the last 5 seasons. Mariners back at T-Mobile Park for a 6-game homestand. They've got the Cubbies in town for 3 this weekend. Jordan Wicks and Bryce Miller is your pitching matchup. 6:40 first pitch on Apple TV+. For sports scores and stories in 30 minutes, I'm Jeff Rust at the Fan Sports Desk. Listen live or on demand on the Odyssey app, the Fan's desktop player, or tell your smart speaker to play 1080 The Fan.
Live, local, and free. No subscription required. Portland's sports leader is 1080 The Fan.
Hello, friends, and welcome to Chehalem Glen Golf Course in beautiful wine country.
for today's worst day on the web. With Danny and Dusty on Odyssey and 1080 The Fan.
That sucks.
Allen Iverson is one of the greatest scorers in NBA history. I loved Allen Iverson. AI. The jean-sagging, do-ragging, gun-toting, dope-smoking phenom who's going to take over the NBA one cornrow at a time, as SI's article when he was drafted out of Georgetown and during his rookie season put it. That is one I will never forget. The lead to that article of Allen Iverson, the jean-sagging, do-ragging, gun-toting, dope-smoking phenom who's taking over the NBA one cornrow at a time.
Yeah, that's... There's a lot there.
Yes, there was. But Allen Iverson was one of the most electric players in the NBA. Think of the teams that the team that he took the NBA Finals in Philadelphia. I mean, he was incredible. And at his size and the physicality that the game was played with at that point in his career, he was getting to the rim. He wasn't the outside shooter. He was a creator, and he was phenomenal. Whether, you know, who are on those teams? Eric Snow and Jeff McGinnis. Yeah,
exactly. Who were on those teams? Was it Theo Ratliff still there?
I think was maybe Mutombo on one of those teams too in Philly. It was AI. And the Philadelphia 76ers have honored Allen Iverson with quite possibly the tiniest statue that has ever been unveiled. And this is the question that pops into mind. At what point is your statue turned into an insult? Because Allen Iverson is taller than his statue in front of the Philadelphia 76ers practice facility. I'm not kidding. 6'1" AI. Yeah. Is taller than his statue.
Yes.
It's about a 3-foot statue. It looks like something that a college football team would get from winning a rivalry game.
Well, and like even the podium, even with the statue sitting on a podium, Allen Iverson is still taller than it.
And rightfully so. The big hubbub on social media is that the 76ers are getting roasted for it. Now.
Well, and deservedly so.
I think that There's levels to this, because remember the Ronaldo airport in Portugal that he got?
Yes.
Where it did looked nothing like him.
Nothing like him.
It looked more like the melted-faced courtroom sketch of Tom Brady than it did actually Cristiano Ronaldo.
Yes.
But that would be a statue where you go, no. Insulting. The AI statue's actually really good, just very tiny.
Yes,
very tiny.
Very tiny.
And the thing that gets me is that there's a video, and you posted this to at 1080 The Fan on X or Twitter or whatever.
Yeah.
But that, they have all of the other greats and statues of them. They've got a Wilt Chamberlain statue around. They got a Billy Cunningham statue. Did not realize Maurice Cheeks was statue worthy, but he has one. Dr. J obviously has one. Moses Malone, Charles Barkley, the greats of the Philadelphia 76ers, they all have a statue in front of their practice facility. All of them seem much larger than the AI one.
Yeah, okay, so I wasn't the only one that picked up on that. That wasn't just me taking crazy pills.
No. Are they life size? Absolutely not.
Right.
But even to scale, the AI statue is dwarfed in all of this. One thing I do love is that they brought AI back into the fold, though, because for the longest time, like, he wasn't.
Right.
And I think that so much has changed in AI being regarded as, I don't know if Allen Iverson gets the respect that he deserves as being as prolific as he was.
Right. No, you're not wrong. And what's amazing too, is that you go on and even after he moved off from the 76ers and it's like, oh, that's right. He was a Denver Nugget. He was a Detroit Piston.
Yeah.
You know, in those later days, it's like picturing Patrick Ewing in an Orlando Magic uniform.
Well, or Dikembe Mutombo in a Philadelphia 76ers uniform. Do you think he gets the statue? Do you think that Dikembe Mutombo gets the statue eventually?
Wagging the finger.
Now, we were talking about that that team that went to the NBA Finals. Mm-hmm. And you were right. Theo Ratliff was on that team. He started 50 games for the 76ers. That team that went to the finals did have Mutombo.
Aaron McKee.
34-year-old Dikembe Mutombo. It had Allen Iverson, Theo Ratliff, Eric Snow, Mutombo, George Lynch, Aaron McKee. Tony Kukoc was on that team. Tony Kukoc played on that 76ers team. Tyrone Hill. Vernon Maxwell at 35 years old off the bench.
Vernon.
Kevin Ollie, national champion coach. Ollie was on that team. That is not a team that is an NBA Finals team.
That is built for the finals, no.
Not with 34-year-old Dikembe Mutombo.
Yeah.
So AI averaged 31 points per game. The next closest was Theo Ratliff at 12.4.
Oh, wow.
Then Dikembe Mutombo averaged 11. Aaron McKee averaged 11 as well. That was an NBA Finals team.
That's bananas. I didn't realize the disparity there. He literally took that team to the finals by himself.
And just think of this. He did it shooting 32% from three. You know?
Yeah.
Like, he only averaged 4 threes a game. He was not a three-point shooter, and he was only in 6'1 was his listed height. You know? Like, this was back when in the NBA, like, AI, is he 5'11", 6 feet? Maybe?
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe? I mean, he could have told him whatever the hell he wanted to, but Allen Iverson, 11-time All-Star, 4-time scoring champ, 3-time steals champ, and 7-time All-NBA. Dude was incredible. And he has the tiniest statue I've ever seen. It really does. It looks like something that Georgetown would give out for a rivalry game that they play.
Yeah. Can I ask something else, too?
Sure.
What I thought was strange about this? They're outside the practice facility.
Yeah.
Just, I mean, you know, I don't know. Like, don't you do the statues outside the arena?
I don't know. I don't know. I haven't been to the arena in Philly, so I wouldn't know what that situation is.
Well, but it seems like most player statues and you know, honors of that sort, I guess I just took for granted that it seemed like they were always outside of the stadium or arena or what have you, and not at the practice facility.
Do the Blazers need statues? That text coming on the fan text, the Vancouver Ford text line.
Do they need all the banners they have hanging in the rafters either? And all of those retired numbers?
Probably not.
So I think there we go.
I think retiring the number is enough. We have so many retired numbers in Portland.
So many retired numbers.
But, and look.
And there's one number that's been retired twice, right?
Yeah, 30.
Yeah.
30. The great number 30, retired twice by the Portland Trailblazers.
TP and Bobby, was it Bobby Gross?
I think that sounds right. That sounds right.
I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to roll with that. That is fact.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Who would be the first Blazer that gets a statue, though? That's the question.
I mean, do you go chronologically or do you go in order of importance?
I think
there's
in Portland we're so weird in this,
and
that
we're going sentimentality too.
We hold things in such high regard here, character wise, mm-hmm. right? Like I probably would say, because it's so late in the game, the first one that Portland would do would probably be like Maurice Lucas.
Okay,
you do a Maurice Lucas statue with all like the Maurice Lucas Award winners kind of around it.
Okay,
and then you go from there. You go Bill Walton, Clyde Drexler,
Dame. Is that where you start getting into your Jerome Kersey's? Also for the sentimental aspect and what he meant here, and maybe like a duck.
Yeah.
You know?
Just the entire 1992 team.
Look, I mean, that was the heyday.
Yeah.
That was the heyday.
I mean, you go the three, I mean, obviously the three guys that are statue worthy here are Walton, Drexler, and Lillard.
Yes.
I mean, those guys.
In terms of on-court play.
On-court play, yes. 100%. Then you go, maybe they take a page out of the Philly playbook, where you have your big statues and then you have your little statues, where, like, give B. Roy a tiny little statue.
Your big statues and then your participation trophies.
That's right. That's right. But I think those three would be, and then Dr. Jack getting a statue would be awesome.
Yes. As long as you can incorporate the, you know, a plaid sport coat in there somehow and pants.
Yeah. I've seen the pictures of, you know, the great statues of Italy, right? Where you got like Michelangelo statues and stuff and the detail that was in that. Like, yes. They have like sheets. If modern statue makers cannot put plaid on it, then I think that we're in some trouble here.
Valid point.
I think we can do that with certainty. I think we can find a way to get the plaid in there. Bill Shonley statue?
Yeah.
Get a Sean statue?
Yeah, that's definitely necessary. He's got to be one of the... I think if you're going... If you got to go with the top five, you know, Mount Rushmore plus one, you got to go with Walton, Clyde, Dame, Jack, and Sean's.
I think that's a good little...
I think that's a good starting five.
Place to start.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Yeah, Dr. Jack needs to have a fat cigar, too. That's a great text.
Yep.
That's like the Red Auerbach statue in Boston.
Mm-hmm.
I went and saw that. And he's got a big old fat stogie. Yeah, have the fat stogie in there, too. Let's go. This one says, Portland has more retired numbers that are the same number than they do championships. That's sad. That's also very true.
That's also very true.
That's a factual statement. 30 is retired twice, one championship. Yeah, and the Mariners have the Dave Niehaus statue, broadcaster statue. I mean, mm-hmm. You don't need a reason, like a precedent for a Bill Shonley statue. The dude coined Rip City, for God's sakes.
Right?
I think that's enough.
Yeah.
It's the identity of Portland.
He spawned jerseys. City-themed jerseys.
Yeah. All right. That's an interesting one. We'll read some of your texts on this one, too. 503-864-6326. That's a Vancouver Ford text line. Danny Dusty on the Fan.
What's your opinion?
It's thick.
Right, we got some texts here. Do the Blazers need statues? Do the Blazers need statues? What?
No.
Now, this would be a whole other thing. Could you unretire some jerseys and just build statues instead? Like, how cool would it be, like, in front of Moda, or God forbid they ever build an entertainment district, and you have, because, like, the entire 77 starting five team is there, right? If you had, like, all of them, and then Dr. Jack, you know, who famously would take a knee and watch the games, like,
yes,
taking a knee in front of them, and you had all five of those guys, wouldn't that be a cool little ode to them, where it's like, yeah. And unretiring numbers is never going to happen, but I mean, maybe we should think about it, you know?
Right.
Instead,
yeah,
build them statues and pay ode to them in a different way. But like this text says, the unquestioned Mount Rushmore of Trailblazer players is Drexler, Walton, Lillard, and Roy. Roy was a Hall of Fame talent whose career was cut short by injuries, but his greatness was unquestionable. He also never lost a home game to Kobe Bryant when he was healthy and played 30 minutes, was 6-1 against him when Kobe went to three championships in a row, 2008 to 2010. Number five, Jeff Petrie, number five on there.
Okay. Yeah, he gets forgotten
great.
A lot.
Petrie's great.
Yeah.
He was great. But I am, I think like having like a statues area because of the way people fall in love with Portland Trailblazers players because of like what they mean to the community. Like when you said Duck and Jerome,
yeah,
you know, the guys that came back and lived here, like Terry, mm-hmm, and like, hell, Cliff Robinson even,
yep,
you know, who is beloved by the players. Like you could have a forest of statues, and I think fans would love that.
Absolutely.
You know, and
well, and you've got a great space for it too, between Moda and the VMC.
Yeah. Yeah, oh, this is a great text. Have a Jack statue kneeling in front of a Sean's at a desk. That'd be a great one.
Fantastic.
Yeah. With the old Trailblazers lettering like on the front of the logo on the front.
Absolutely.
Like, dude, that'd be great.
Yeah, the old vertical pinwheel.
Yeah. I mean, do the Pirates really have 10-foot statues? Do the Pittsburgh Pirates, is that the one thing that the Pittsburgh Pirates do well?
Is the statues? They get the statues right?
Yeah.
Sure.
God, oh my God, these are gigantic. What in the world? Look, Pittsburgh's statue game is on point. The Steelers need to do this. Could you imagine big old fat Ben Roethlisberger statue? It's like, what era of Ben do we build this statue in? You know?
Is it the bathroom one?
Go. You went, yeah, you did it.
I did it.
Can't take you anywhere. You have like a big old Ben Roethlisberger. Like, this is like what? It's not even what era. It's like what point in any given season that Ben Roethlisberger played. I'd never seen a player. Ben Roethlisberger would come into a season in like season opener, September. You're sitting there and you look at him and you go, "Well, Ben looks svelte." Every November, that dude, he added a layer for those Pittsburgh winters. Yeah. Whether it was like bandages and braces or just like that little extra nice love that he got on him. Ben Roethlisberger would just be a different looking player every year from like September to November.
Let's face it too. If they do a Ben Roethlisberger statue, it has to be him making the face from that meme. Just the, oh.
Oh. Oh.
I mean, right? It's got to be that one.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. Let's get to hour number three here on this Friday. Let's start with taking a little inventory of where the Oregon Ducks are. Halfway through spring ball, a lot of new faces and a lot of big shoes to fill. Danny and Dusty on the Fan. All right, hour number three, Danny and Dusty on this Friday afternoon. A beautiful sometimes Friday afternoon. Les Grossman is my co-host for this segment. He's here.
That's a Jeff good choice.
Jeff Rust is here as well. No Danny Meringue. He's at the Nike Hoop Summit. We'll be back on Monday. Unless something happens summiting the hoop. And I don't know. We don't want to be presumptuous here.
No.
You can watch on youtube.com/1080amthefan, twitch.tv/1080thefan, or 1080amthefan.
Yes.
You got to get the AM in there. Or 99.5 HD2 in the Odyssey app. So thanks for listening, everybody. Love y'all. Love y'all out there. Let's take a little inventory of Oregon football here. Midway through spring ball. Spring game, April 27th. Spring games are going to get going this weekend. Fox is airing the Ohio State spring game this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow, they've got the Ohio State spring game, which that could get a massive number. We just talked about this last hour. There's no NBA games
tomorrow
on Saturday.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
So, I mean, they're really just going up against the Masters.
Baseball and golf.
Yeah.
Baseball and golf is what they're going up against. So, Fox has got the Ohio State spring game, which I'm going to be very interested in because of the fact that so many new moving parts. They went into the portal and they dominated the dojo with the portal. But then also what they did with their coaching staff. They go and they get Chip Kelly. Head coach at UCLA, he goes, now you have the brain trust of Ryan Day and Chip Kelly, which people can, you know, criticize them as head coaches all they want over the last couple of years, but their offensive minds individually are brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
You bring them together, Ohio State's going to be a problem. They are going to be a big problem.
Yes.
In college football. And I think all Oregon and Washington fans, USC and UCLA fans, all eyes should be on that game as well, because as you enter the Big Ten, that is now a conference opponent. Next weekend, Fox is airing the Michigan spring game. And then the following Saturday, April 27th, you got Oregon kicking off their spring game. That game is going to be on the Pac-12 network.
Is that their last show?
No. Dang.
Too soon.
Yeah. But look, Oregon's got some big holes that they got to fill. I mean, you think of this. Bo Nix, Troy Franklin, Jackson Power Johnson, Bucky Irving, Kyrie Jackson, Brandon Dorlus. Those are six bona fide draft picks. I mean, JPJ, everywhere you look right now,
mm-hmm.
you are seeing first round grade on him and first round pick. You know, Bo Nix could be a guy that you do see enter day one of the draft. More than likely than not, day two.
Probably. But yeah, he's borderline.
But the new Mel Kiper mock draft that is up right now has the New York Giants trading up to the 33rd pick,
mm-hmm.
getting Bo Nix with that 33rd pick, the first pick of the second round. With Malik Nabers being the pick for the Giants at six?
Six?
Yeah, at six.
Sounds about right.
Because it goes Arizona, L.A., and then I believe the Giants are sitting right there. But you have those six players just in and of themselves, huge shoes to fill.
Yes.
Then you add on top of that some of the role players that are going to be gone, whether it is, you know, Evan Williams or Casey Rogers, Popo Amavai. This is one time where, like, if you rewind a handful of years ago, you go rebuild year, not reload year. The transfer portal obviously has changed the game, and then Oregon's ability to recruit over the last, you know, six, seven years has amplified things to where it is a retool and a reload as opposed to a rebuild. And that is, there are always going to be question marks, though. And as much as, you know, getting the transfer portal additions of Dylan Gabriel and Dante Moore, they're huge for Oregon in their quarterback room. They absolutely are. But the one thing that nobody could take away was not just from last year, the experience that Bo Nix had, but it was year two at Oregon,
mm-hmm.
and familiarity with the pieces around him. Now, the system was different, slightly different with Will Stein as opposed to Kenny Dillingham.
Right.
But everything was conceptually the same. The offensive line, your skill guys, all the same. It was an easy transition for Bo Nix. into Will Stein last year. The quarterback room, Dylan Gabriel, I mean, you sit there and you go, all right, the guy who quite literally has the most starts in college football history, you are replacing him with the guy who, if he plays every game, will have the most starts in college football history.
Hey, nothing like experience, right?
And that is huge. And look, by all accounts and everything that you hear, Dylan Gabriel is that guy, mm-hmm. right? We know him from his time at Central Florida. Before the injury, he was an electric player at Central Florida. Then yeah. he goes to Oklahoma, and he was really damn good at Oklahoma last year. Last year especially, last couple of years, he is that guy.
Yes.
The depth, though, is what is the most important part, because you when you go through spring ball, you start hearing the same names over and over again from the media availability, right? And you hear, like, Dante Moore, he's got every tool to be that guy. But then you hear the names Austin Novosad, who last year was a guy that they brought in late, and he was an early enrollee, and he came in kind of midway through spring ball.
Right.
And he was raw and young, but you keep hearing his name pop up. Luke Moga, the four-star recruit out of Arizona that they got, which I love the fact that you have an early enrollee quarterback and a kid who commits and stays with it even after Dylan Gabriel and Dante Moore
right.
Come on board. He's like, I love to compete. So you have a solid core of guys that could play right now. And then the developmental aspect, when you continue to hear the name Novosad pop up in the media availabilities, when players and coaches are talking about his growth and development, you're looking at that room is going to be okay. And that step back from Bo Nix, look, there will be a step back. Bo Nix was special.
Yeah.
Bo Nix was a special quarterback.
Yeah. Well, he was perfect for what they were asking him to do and for the system that they had.
And that is not as drastic of a step back as, you know, it seems on the surface because of Dylan Gabriel, because mm-hmm. of the depth that is behind him, but also because I think I'm really excited about the receiver room that Oregon has. It's deep, man. I mean, you're looking at it just on the surface of guys that are returning, right? Tez Johnson, Trayshawn Holden, Gary Bryant Jr. You've heard, you know, the rumblings of, you know, a healthy and some seasoning on Jurion Dickey in that receiver room. Kyler Casper is a guy that expectations are he takes that next step up, and it's a big body target. Mm-hmm. Casper is a monster. He is so damn tall. He's like 6'6", 6'7".
That's tall.
A very tall receiver and skilled. But then you start comfort and growth in the offense, especially with those last two, Jurion Dickey and Kyler Casper. You're looking at six deep, right? And then you add those five, and then you add the sixth. Evan Stewart, the Texas A&M transfer, he could have the potential to be that game-changing wide receiver. And look, Troy Franklin was that guy that everybody kind of been waiting for at Oregon, right? The guy who, third down, you knew you could rely on him, but he was also primed for a big play. Mm-hmm. Evan Stewart is a dude. Mm-hmm. He's not small. He's physically put together. And that receiver room is six deep where you feel comfortable if you were to start have to play a game like today, right?
Yeah.
Just on those names, if you were to roll out, you know, you're starting four wide receivers of Evan Stewart, Tez Johnson, Trayshawn Holden, and then Gary Bryant Jr., those are knowns that you have right there. And that doesn't include guys that are early enrollee freshmen like Jeremiah McClellan, who came in as a highly touted prospect, Dylan Gresham, who comes in as a highly touted prospect at receiver. You enter this season with a lot of knowns of what you have in that room. And that I'm saying that to say it eases any of those, all right, Bo Nix was special because it was not just the experience he had, but it was year two in the Oregon system and familiarity with it. The skill positions around Dylan Gabriel, who has experience out the yin-yang, but also has guys who have been in or either been in the system for a while for Oregon or is a seasoned receiver like Evan Stewart, who is a number one, no doubt.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then you add that running back room where the return of Noah Whittington, Jordan James, Jaden Lamar are back. That D2 transfer from Northwest Missouri State, Jay Harris, where I know that it kind of flew under the radar because it was like he's a D2 guy who transferred. I flipped on tape of that dude. He is big, strong, and fast. He's a mover, man. I mean, it is, when you look at that running back room, all of a sudden, you've got four again. And do you have Bucky Irving and the versatility of Bucky Irving? It's going to be hard to replace, but Noah Whittington is a guy that you can rely on as a back out. I thought Jordan James as a receiver became more and more reliable as last season went on as well.
Yeah, it's a look. There's, like you said, this is going to be a new look team. But I think it's very exciting to see how some of these new pieces that we've just seen some flashes from, who didn't get a ton of playing time before, will be under a bigger spotlight.
Also, the tight end room with Terrence Ferguson, Patrick Herbert, and then Kenyon Sadiq, who yesterday we heard from Drew Maringer, the tight ends coach, raving about Kenyon Sadiq, who was a freshman last year, got some run, got his first touchdown in the Fiesta Bowl last January. You have the receiving threats and the blocking threats can kind of be that extension. We talk about this all the time. I truly do believe with this era in college football, in football in general, the tight end position is more valuable than it's ever been before.
Yeah.
And to have those guys that you can kind of lean on. And then this isn't to say, have you seen the pictures of this Roger Sapalaga?
No.
True freshman out of Utah, early enrollee. I saw a picture of the dude rolling into practice, and it was like, that's a grown-ass man. That is not a kid that should be in high school. And you take, like...
He's a big-ass boy.
He's a big-ass boy. He's a big-ass... There is different dudes that are rolling in right there.
Yeah.
And then the offensive line, offensively, Jackson Powers Johnson, that's the biggest question mark that you have. I mean, yeah. Oregon went from Alex Forsythe to JPJ as their starting center. That right there, every other position, and this may be kind of where... everything kind of falls into place, is where the comfort is at guard, because they went from an NFL caliber off center in the Remington Award winner in Jackson Powers Johnson. Replacing that is way harder than we give it credit for. Center is the most important position because he's the brain of the operation.
Yes.
He sets your protections. He identifies and communicates on both sides, like it of the offensive line.
Yeah, and literally has his hand on the ball every play.
Now, your right tackle is far more important with a left-handed quarterback in Dylan Gabriel this year. But the tackles are set. The guards, you have experience coming back. That center position, that is the one where... In the spring game, we very rarely, everybody's going to be focused on all the skill position guys that we just talked about. That center position is going to be where my focus is on, because of the fact that they went from NFL guy, Remington Award finalist, to Remington Award winner in a year.
Yeah.
And that does not happen.
No.
That position offensively is the most important for me in this spring ball, and everything else will fall into place around it.
Yeah, this I'm excited to see what happens and see if, you know, maybe this year old Coach Lanny can get that Washington monkey off his back.
This is definitely a year to do it.
Yeah,
they lose a lot, and Jed Fish is a damn good football coach at UW. But what they are having to replace, they did not go about it because they didn't backload recruiting classes like Oregon has.
Yeah.
And they were not as active in the portal in getting and landing the big name players. Now, this is not Washington is going to be a tough game. It always will be.
Yes.
It always will be. But you're right. That is kind of the next step as everybody looks at. In the defense, we're talking about the big shoes to fill offensively. The defense has got some massive ones too. Let's dive into that a little bit, because the portal with Evan Stewart, Dylan Gabriel, Dante Moore, they got a lot there. Defensively, they got a ton out of the portal, and as we're at the midway point of spring ball, we heard from one of their portal guys yesterday who he could be a real dude for the Ducks next on The Fan. Oregon's offense and kind of the retooling that we will see. A lot of familiar names, a lot of new names coming in. But that center position is the one that everybody's kind of going to have their eyes on as spring game is April 27th. We're midway through spring ball for the Ducks down in Eugene. On the defensive side of the football, look, there's no other way to put it. Like, the defensive line is going to be the one where eyes will be at, because Brandon Dorlus, Popo Amavai, and Casey Rogers, very tough to replace. Easing that blow is Jordan Birch back for another year, Keon Ware-Hudson, Ben Roberts, all returning. That helps. But Dorlus, if you look at Dorlus, the eighth-ranked defensive tackle in this draft on a lot of places. Moving up, though, and you see guys like Jim Nagy, the Senior Bowl executive director, he's like, that drop-off from like 1-2-3 and where Dorlus is not that far. And we may see Brandon Dorlus going on day two of the draft. And those are big shoes to fill on the interior. It'll be interesting to see who emerges from a young group. You got, was it Jeremy Caldwell, the transfer out of Houston? He's coming in this year. It's a young group in the middle, but with Ware-Hudson, Roberts, and Birch back, that one is going to be, especially in the Big Ten, where you have to be stout up the middle of your defense. What eases that a little bit is that they're absolutely loaded on the edge on the defensive lines with Mateo Ungalale and Blake Purchase, Bryce Betcher on the interior, who they kind of move him inside, outside, but Tatum Tuioti, who we saw as a freshman last year, come up with big plays, and Amarion Winston. The edge is loaded. And then you have Elijah Rushing, the prospect that he was the late flip from Arizona on signing day. He does not look like, we were talking about Sepulaga, the tight end from Utah, who came in as a true freshman early enrollee. This kid is 6'6", 250 in every bit of it. He should be a high school senior. He should be going, get ready to go to prom.
Man.
And these guys are rolling out there. Edge is going to be loaded. That eases the blow. And then you have that linebacking core, especially on the interior, when you have Jeffrey Boss, who's coming off the Fiesta Bowl MVP, and Justin Jacobs, who once he got healthy, you saw how damn good he was in the interior. And going with Bryce Betcher, who they kind of floated him on the inside linebacker and outside linebacker positions. That can ease kind of what you're doing on the interior of your defensive line, because that front seven is very stout everywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The defensive backfield, I'm really excited to see for Oregon, because we just heard from Kobe Savage yesterday for the first time since he transferred in from Kansas State. Dude looks like he can squat the entire team. Like, he is a load. And at Kansas State, he was a missile all over the field. Now, when you are replacing so many key pieces from the secondary from a year ago, obviously Kyrie Jackson was an absolute dude for Oregon. And having a long, rangy corner, Evan Williams was kind of that do-everything. And you see in Kobe Savage, from what he did at Kansas State, very similar in respect to a guy that can be a Swiss Army knife for you in coverage, run support, kind of being all over the field. And I feel like Dan Lanning and Tosh Lapointe, that's the way they're going to use him. Very similar to, you know, Evan Williams, which we saw last year, tackles for loss, Evan Williams was third on the team. That's your safety coming up in support and being your third leading tackler for loss. He is going to be invaluable to the development and growth of this team. And then you replace Kyrie Jackson with Jabbar Muhammad from Washington, which you think of the blow that gave to Washington secondary. Mm-hmm. That was one guy who would have been returning from a team that lost so much, especially on the offensive side of the football. Those guys are going to be huge, but you pair them with Tysheem Johnson, which we saw his growth, especially in that Utah game, came up huge for Oregon a couple of times. Nico Reed, Jahlil Florence, and then Roderick Pleasant, who got some run, and then the injury bug started biting. But the guy, like, you look for these rangy, long corners, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they got, I think, a guy who's flying under the radar that to kind of keep an eye on for a guy who's going to get a lot of playing time, but nobody really knows about, is Sione Laule, the JUCO transfer, okay. San Mateo, 6'4", corner. You're looking for them pterodactyls out on the outside, right? And long, rangy guys to kind of flip the difference stylistically. And this is what it's all about, right? Speed and size, length, right? You can flip in between those stylistically with who you're playing in a Big Ten conference, right? Because if you're playing lining up against Ohio State, it's a completely different style than if you are lining up against an Iowa team, right? Where you want a longer, rangy guy who on the outside can just give hell to wide receivers that they don't want to throw the ball to anyway. But eliminators at the line of scrimmage, long, rangy guys, huge.
Yeah.
In especially like Iowa's one, Wisconsin is another. The physicality that those schools bring to the line of scrimmage, you're going to want to sit there and you want to play them a little bit tighter to the line of scrimmage. That is kind of where the portal and that those stacking of recruiting classes, the defense is making a lot more sense in the vein of what Dan Lanning has done in his previous stops, whether it's Alabama or Georgia and now at Oregon. You're starting to see kind of filling those holes with those guys that make that sense. It is like there's a lot of reason for optimism at Oregon because of what they were able to do in the transfer portal and getting those instant band-aids, because there's a lot of youth on this team. There's no way about it. We think of a guy like Roderick Pleasant, who's fast as hell,
mm-hmm.
and can run with anybody in the country. But they are young and inexperienced. You go to the portal, you get a guy like Jabbar Muhammad, you get a guy like Kobe Savage. You're putting those band-aids on until ultimately it is growth and development of what Oregon is looking at.
Yeah, and the one thing it seems like that Lanning has done well since he's been here is it can be easy to get sucked into recruiting and think of it maybe, I guess, as a you know, this year type thing. But he's been good about trying to look forward and look ahead to see what holes will need to be filled and when.
You just gotta, like, in a lot of this is you're taking it in as a fan and you are going through and, you know, the videos that get posted of post practice stuff. It's all the stuff of looking at the recruiting, look at what they've done in the portal, and hearing the names that keep popping up,
right? Mm-hmm.
Keep popping up. That's what spring ball is all about, like reading those tea leaves, because we won't really know until April 27th what this looks like. And one thing that we saw last year with their spring game is the breaking up of their team. It's not ones versus twos.
Mm-hmm.
It is they distribute the talent evenly and then bring it together for the spring game. But
yeah,
it is, we've heard a lot of names coming out of guys in that development and growth, and it's been fun to see, man.
And I part of me, you know, this is maybe just picking nits here, but part of me wonders why more programs and schools, why they continue to go ones versus twos.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting one, because if you look at what that does is it establishes your pecking order,
mm-hmm.
and guys know, like, I'm a two, I'm a three.
Right.
Whereas when you split it up evenly, and that's what most of the big programs do,
mm-hmm.
is they just split it up evenly, and they don't have a depth chart.
Okay.
They don't have a depth chart.
Right.
Because you know what the depth chart does? Sends guys to the portal.
Right. Yeah. No, exactly.
And what this does is it allows them to compete on an even plane with the guys that are around them.
Mm-hmm.
In that, it's really interesting to see. All right, 503-864-6326. That is the Vancouver Ford text line. All right, we've got quite a few votes in on this, and the takes are flying after Restra Sports Center.
Now, from the Fan Sports Desk, a Sports Center update on 1080 The Fan.
Jeff Rust here with your Sports Center update. First on The Fan, round two of the Masters rapidly coming to a close at Augusta National. And at the top of the leaderboard, we've got Bryson DeChambeau and Scottie Scheffler, each at 7 under par. They are one stroke clear of Max Homa. And then at fourth place is Nikolaj Højgaard at 4 under par. That is 3 strokes off the pace. Some other notable names: Colin Morikawa, 3 under par. He's done for the day. Tiger Woods also done for the day. He is 1 over overall. Will Zalatoris also 1 over, alongside Rory McIlroy. Phil Mickelson, 2 over par. Jason Day and John Rahm are both at 4 over, and it looks as though they could be safe and will head to the weekend. All 30 teams in the NBA on the schedule tonight, and the Blazers certainly are one of them, hosting the Rockets at Moda Center, 7 o'clock tip on Root Sports. Portland 6.5-point underdogs. Kentucky has officially named Mark Pope as their new men's basketball coach. He was a captain on the Wildcats' 1996 national championship team and has been the head coach at BYU for the last five seasons. Over on the diamond, Mariners back at T-Mobile Park for a six-game homestand. They got the Cubbies in town for a three-game set this weekend. Jordan Wicks, Bryce Miller are your starting pitchers. 6:40 first pitch on Apple TV+. More sports scores and stories in 30 minutes. I'm Jeff Rust at the Fan Sports Desk. Listen live or on demand on the Odyssey app, the Fan's desktop player, or tell your smart speaker to play 1080 The Fan.
If you can't find the humor in today's NBA, you're doing it wrong. Heat Check with Trista Crick on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
All right, we have a poll up at Danny and Dusty, inspired by the great Damon Stoudemire. Better fast food burger joint, Burgerville or In-N-Out? This stems from Damon Stoudemire at 8:20 Pacific time, which would be 11:20, where he is the head men's basketball coach at Georgia Tech, tweeted, unprompted, a response to a Portland Business Journal In-N-Out inching closer to Portland. Burgerville is better. And first place he goes to is Burgerville anytime he's in Portland. And he's having none of this In-N-Out stuff. Which is better? 62.1% saying Burgerville. 37.9%
are dummies.
For
bad taste.
In-N-Out. The takes are a-flying. The takes are a-flying here. We have... I'm tempted to vote for In-N-Out just because of how expensive Burgerville burgers have gotten. It's $4 for a plain cheeseburger versus $5 for a double-double with toppings and animal style. Like,
I think it's
come
like $3.29 for the burger, but, you
okay.
know.
We have a... Burgerville has gotten way better on with their wait time. They used to take for freaking ever.
Yeah,
now,
Burgerville was not speedy.
Now that they've unionized, oh, they're as fast as anyone on getting orders out. Because of that massive improvement, got to put them above In-N-Out.
Now, going back to that previous comment, what would you rather have? A good, a very fine, somewhat more expensive, tasty burger or a cheaper hunk of crap?
I would... I don't think In-N-Out is a hunk of crap, though. That's where my pushback is. But the price is pretty similar. And you know what? I like just the regular cheeseburger from Burgerville.
That's what I get every time.
That I do, too.
Like two of them.
Like a lot of people, though, they're like, go Tillamook cheeseburger or die. Mm-hmm. Dude, I'll take the regular.
Yeah.
I take the regular every time. I get two of those bad boys. Let's roll. Let's party.
Absolutely.
Better quality food, Burgerville. Best value, In-N-Out. Burgerville's too expensive. And then we have Tom, who just says, I've never been to either one, which is wild.
Does he live here? I don't understand. Like, if you're a longtime resident here and you've lived here a long time, I don't understand how you've never been to a Burgerville.
Me neither. We have one vote for Little Big Burger. We have a couple folks are saying, like, I'd rather have, like, Killer Burger or Little Big Burger.
Well, that's all fine and dandy, but that's not the question.
It's not the conversation we have here.
Yeah.
It's not the conversation at hand.
Killer Burger's great. Five Guys is great. Little Big Burger, just fine. It's been a while since I've been there, but, yeah.
Since we moved buildings, I used to go to Little Big Burger all the time.
Yeah.
At the old building. We were right down the street.
Yeah,
Little Big Burger was good. They've
it was
got
walking
the,
distance.
Yeah. And they had they have the truffle fries. So good.
Yeah.
And the fry sauce is really good too.
Right.
I'm a bit of a burger connoisseur. It is what I grew up with.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing with the Burgerville too, is you gotta get a side of the Burgerville spread for your fries.
Yeah. I mean, in like growing up in the burger world, it was a big deal for me. Like pizza hard to screw up, right? Pizza hard to screw up.
Mm-hmm.
Burgers very easy to screw up, very easy to screw up. Too greasy, too dry. Your toppings have got to be on point, and the bun selection is crucial. And I will say, Burgerville superior bun.
Yeah,
superior bun.
Yeah.
Superior bun.
Absolutely.
On that one. So keep the votes coming in. This is going to be a vicious cockfight to the end. And right now, Burgerville running away. More votes. Oh, more votes have come in. And Burgerville up to 62.6% of the vote.
Hello, friends.
While In-N-Out is at 37.4. This is Dustin J. Hera. Not my real middle name. With your serious news report.
What is it? What do we got? What are we flying with over there for the middle moniker? Is it like a Dustin Allen?
What is my actual middle name?
Dustin Robert.
What is my actual middle name?
Yeah.
Andrews.
Andrews.
Yeah.
Plural.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Cool.
A lot of generations in the Hera family have that
really?
Middle name. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's so think, family name.
I think Bennett is like seven. The seventh one to have it.
He's got Andrews too?
Yeah, he does.
Excellent.
He's got it.
Right on.
He's got it.
That's cool.
I was going for Machine Gun, but that got shot down. and so we went with the family name.
I just don't even know how to respond to that.
My wife didn't either.
Other than with no.
No. No. All right. We'll wrap this bad boy up before we hand you off to primetime with Sook. For the YouTubers watching, Val Kilmer, the great Doc Holliday.
Yeah, he's your Huckleberry.
Is my co-host for this segment after Les Grossman was with us. A surprise guest for our final co-host in the chair of death because it did start with Kim Jong-un. So, kind of got to call it that. Danny Dusty on the Fan. As the Portland Trailblazers embark on a quest to wrap up one of the worst records in the NBA, they are one game back of both San Antonio and Charlotte, currently sitting with the fifth worst record in the NBA. They could bolster their lottery odds with the help of the Boston Celtics tonight. Boston plays Charlotte, and on the injury report for the Boston Celtics, get ready for this one, okay? 62-18. A 13-game lead on the second-place Milwaukee Bucks. And the injury report for Boston includes Jaylen Brown, left hand sprain, out. Jrue Holiday, patella tendinopathy, out. Al Horford, big toe sprain, out. That sounds painful. Kristaps Porzingis, don't really need anything there, but he's out. Jason Tatum, right knee contusion, out. Derek White, left ankle sprain, out.
Hmm.
If you're wondering who that leaves them with, it is Jordan Walsh, Xavier Tillman, Jaden Springer, Nemus Queta, Peyton Pritchard.
Hey.
Drew Peterson, Zvi Mihalik, Luke Kornet, Sam Hauser, J.D. Davison, and O'Shea Brissett.
So you're telling me there's a chance.
There is a chance. Look, but I'll go back to the Blazers did not try to win that game and found a way to win against Charlotte. All right?
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
All right. So you got that going for you, which is nice.
Which is nice.
Masters update. Tiger Woods set the record. He has surpassed Freddie Couples, Gary Player, for the most consecutive Masters cuts made, 24 in a row. He went even par today, one over for the tournament. He is 8 strokes back of Scottie Scheffler, who is on the 12th hole right now at 1 under par on today's round, 7 under overall. Max Homa, Bryson DeChambeau, both in the clubhouse at 6 under par. And this leaderboard is shaping up to be awesome heading into the weekend. Yeah. But you know what could be even better for us? Tomorrow we could have a weekend pairing. Tiger Woods, Phil Mickelson.
Oh, that would be gold.
Wouldn't that be money? There's a very real possibility that we could have Phil Mickelson and Tiger Woods, y'all, together. Phil just bogeyed 14, and so he is at 2 over par now. We need him. We need a birdie. All right.
If that pairing does happen.
Yes.
What do you place the over under at in terms of words spoken to each other?
7.
Yeah.
7.
I feel like that'd be yeah.
Actually, no, I think they're going to be more chatty.
You think so?
I think they will be. I think they will be.
You think they've let, you know, bygones be bygones?
Yeah. All right. I mean, older, gentler, both of them.
Yeah.
Both of them are.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. A guy who's in jeopardy of missing the cut right now, Wyndham Clark, U.S. Open winner. He is 3 over on today's round, and he's on the 11th hole. He is at 4 over par. If you look at the...
Which is the current cut, at least at last check.
Nope. It has bumped up to plus 5.
Oh, okay.
It has bumped up to plus 5. So if you get to 6 over, you out, my dude.